We're traveling a little bit into the future with Polestar's first all-electric, the 2. Let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racing driver and lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for driving enthusiasts like us. Now, with Polestar, I'm so old school that I remember when the company was Volvo's performance tuning division. No, I'm just kidding. That was only 5 years ago. Not that old school. Now, under Geely, things have changed. In some ways, they haven't changed in that Volvo continues to produce very attractive, very safe cars. But Polestar has been transformed into an EV brand, and this Polestar 2 is the company's first BEV. Yes, it's not a hybrid, it is a full EV. And this is going to be interesting. Since this is an electric, Polestar has taken advantage of packaging and put a motor in the front and the back, making it all-wheel drive. Very cool. Each motor produces 150 kilowatts and 330 newton meters of torque for a total conventional output of 408 horsepower and 487 pounds of torque for Luddites like me. Powering those motors is a 78 kilowatt hour battery and is said to have a 291 mile or 470 kilometer range per standard industry testing. Not too bad. We've all heard stories about the environmental and social impacts of rare Earth's mining, and Polestar has taken that to heart. The cobalt used in their cars is responsibly mined. Very cool. The chassis is a unibody, of course. It is related to the XC40 that we know in this part of the world. It is also related to a bunch of different products sold under Geely and Lynx & Co. brands. And the battery case is actually made of extruded aluminum, and of course it rightly sits at the bottom of the car. Suspension is McPherson struts up front, multi-link rear. This one has the performance pack, so it's got the Öhlins dual flow valve dampers, which I've liked in other products. Brakes are discs. Obviously, this one has the performance pack, so it's got Brembos, and these things are pretty cool looking. Wheels are either 19s or 20s. Again, this has the performance pack, so it's got the forged 20-inch wheels. There are some interior considerations, and Volvo says that this is free of any animal products, making it a vegan interior. A word about this vegan interior. I think it's fantastic. I'm certainly no vegan, but this is exactly what more manufacturers should be doing. And this is exactly what I would design if I were responsible for interiors at Polestar. The cloth looks great, seems hard wearing, the steering wheel covering feels great in your hand as well. It's not leather, and this is just all around wonderful. It's not hot in the summer, it's not cold in the winter, it's just perfection. More manufacturers need to take note of what Polestar is doing here. This is fantastic. And again, I'm no vegan, I'm gonna get back to lunch. Of course, you can get a leather interior with your Polestar 2, but I certainly advocate for this vegan interior. Curb weight is about 4,700 pounds. Weight distribution, static weight distribution, is roughly 50-50, which should make this a good handler. And you can actually tow about 2,000 pounds with your Polestar 2 if you so desire. It's that time in the episode 4, how to spec your Polestar 2. Base price in the United States is $59.9, in Canada it's $69.9. This one that you're looking at has magnesium paint at $1,200, both US and Canadian, and the all-important performance pack, all-important if you are like-minded like us, at $5,000 US or $6,000 Canadian. Void is the standard color. All other colors that are available are $1,200 US or Canadian. There is a Napa leather option in barley color that's $4,000 US or $5,000 Canadian. The performance pack is our kind of options. Öhlins dampers, stiffer sway bars, the signature Polestar gold four-piston Brembo calipers on the front, 20-inch forged wheels, Continental Sport Contact 6 tires, and the coolest thing, gold seat belts and valve caps. So with the optional magnesium paint and the performance pack, this is $66,100 US as tested. In Canada, it's $77,100, and that's before freight, local taxes, EV credits, and any applicable rebates where you live. Now, how do you spec yours? Well, the process is fairly easy because options are limited, colors are limited. Pick the color that you like. I'm not a fan of this magnesium paint, a little too bright for me. I certainly do advocate for the vegan interior, and that's for reasons we discussed, as well as the performance pack, which we will get into as we drive this a little bit more. But how to spec yours? Fairly straightforward process because options and features are fairly limited, so have fun speccing your Polestar 2.
The first thing you notice when you drive this Polestar 2 is the very low center of gravity because that battery pack sits way down low. Best thing though, though, is that it doesn't compromise seating position. This is an ideal seating position for me. I'm sitting nice and low in the car and lots of adjustment in the seat and the steering column to get me set up perfectly behind the wheel. Volvo's DNA is prevalent throughout the car, especially inside, and these seats are very Volvo-like. They're very supportive, very, very comfortable, and they're firm enough so that you can be very, very well rested after a long drive. With this body style, visibility isn't bad. There is a little window opening that you can peer through the mirror, but when you're parking, it's pretty straightforward. There are 360-degree cameras and sensors. This front row is very spacious, and yes, I can sit behind my seating position in the back, but that back seat is a little more cramped. This is, you know, more on the size of a Volvo S60 or V60 in terms of that second row, but overall it's not too bad. Lots of cargo room in the front as well. Unlike that last V60 Polestar tuned I drove, which had no storage underneath the armrest, there are some unusual things like the slot for the wireless charging of your phone. That kind of goes here. It tends to collect dust and garbage, so be mindful of that. There's a little bit of storage beside that. One cup holder here and some cup holders or bottle holders in the doors as well. So there's a reasonable amount of storage here, and it is relatively spacious, so you and your passengers can be comfortable. What is impressive is the storage under the boot. There is a ton of different configurations there. It's very, very straightforward, very easy to use. And of course, since it's an EV, there's a little more space there that you'd expect underneath the hatch of a car of this size. Ergonomically, there's a lot of Volvo going on here. The steering wheel seems lifted straight out of another Volvo. The window switches are, the turn signal, the wiper stalk, this infotainment controller certainly. This infotainment system is all new, however, it is Android-based. There is an Apple CarPlay update coming over the air, so if you've got one of these on order, take delivery soon, and are an Apple user, not to worry, you can get your CarPlay on there. I certainly prefer this, but with respect to the Google support here, it is actually quite good. The Google Maps is remarkably good, very intuitive, very easy to use as well, and it is quick. Unlike some other infotainment systems and other cars that are slow, this one is quite good as it sits. I still prefer CarPlay. We know that instant torque is the hallmark of EVs, so let's give acceleration a try, shall we? I love that. This is exceptionally quick for what it is. I mean, it is thoroughly enjoyable to use that throttle. Polestar says this will do 0 to 60 in about 4.5 seconds. That seems about right. Tops out at 127 miles an hour, which is more than what you need. I'm curious what the real top speed would be. I'm not sure if that's limited by drag or electronics. What I am impressed with is the way in which it puts down power. And on lower grip surfaces or near its limits of grip, what I do find is that it is rear drive based. So there seems to be a little more torque getting delivered to the rear tires than the front, making this more like a rear driver overall, certainly in those extreme situations. But in regular driving, all four tires are just digging for traction. And on these Continental Sport Contact 6, well, there's no trouble with grip, that's for sure. There are three EV drive modes with respect to the amount of regenerative braking. And what I do find, I am on the most aggressive mode right now, but I'd prefer one more. It isn't as aggressive as I'd like. I think if you're driving normally, it seems to be perfectly fine. If you're enjoying canyon roads like I am and want to roll into a corner, well, you do have to use the brake pedal, and more on brake pedal feel in a second. The best thing about EVs is that linear torque delivery. It doesn't matter what speed you're doing, just lean into that throttle pedal and you've got instantaneous response and just tons and tons of torque available. It's amazing. The steering has three levels of assist. I just keep it on the lightest one, as I always do. There's no need for artificial heft, especially when you're driving long distances. You don't need artificially heavy steering, and this is an electric-based assist system, of course. There's not a lot of feedback that comes through this wheel. Overall, steering response is quite good. It's very linear, very direct. I'm very, very happy with this steering system. What I am very happy with are my favorite things: handling and braking. First, braking. As I understand, calibrating a regenerative braking system with a conventional braking system is not easy, especially when it comes to pedal feel. What Polestar has done here is an excellent job blending those two together. So regenerative braking is, you know, always on. As soon as I lift off the throttle, well, we're instantaneously braking because I've got the car set to aggressive regenerative braking, and that's another story. But what I do like is the pedal feel. The brake pedal feel is excellent. It's firm. You can feel really what's going on even when you're driving aggressively. I'd love to drive this on the racetrack, and based on the wear on these tires, someone's already done that with this tester. But dynamically, as I'm doing here, carving the corners in this canyon, well, handling is just excellent, and that's for two reasons. First reason is the battery pack sits at the bottom of the car. Yes, it's protected by that extruded aluminum case, but with that low center of gravity, that just changes the dynamics equation straight from the drop. This is an excellent handling car, and I'm very impressed. I think what makes the car is the performance pack with the Öhlins dampers. Yes, it does ride on the firmer side, but body and wheel control is excellent. These Öhlins dampers are some of the finest conventional dampers I've driven. I'm sure I've said this before, but they do an excellent job of controlling body and wheel motion. They are absolutely fantastic in every condition. On rougher roads, yes, I suspect the spring rates are a little bit higher than you'd expect for a mid-size kind of BEV like this. And yes, you could go softer perhaps with the standard suspension, but if you're a driving enthusiast like us, you probably want the suspension. You want it for the forged wheels, you want it for the tires, and you certainly want it for these dampers. This is an excellent dynamics package. Because that battery pack is sitting so low in this car, body roll is at a minimum, as is dive and pitch. It is an impressive overall package, and the way they've designed this as an EV certainly helps. My verdict, well, I do have to say that this Polestar 2 is exceptionally well put together and very well resolved as a complete package, especially when you consider that this is their first attempt at a BEV. That I'm very much impressed with. It is very much of the time. It's not bleeding edge like some other EVs where they use their customers as beta testers for their autonomous driving tech. No, this is very straightforward, very much of the time, and it's been an impressive drive, that's for sure. To me, it makes a compelling argument for this Polestar 2 against some of the existing EVs that are out there, and it is a very interesting piece. I thoroughly enjoyed driving it. If you're interested in something like this, you will have to check this out. Take this for a drive. I'm curious to see if anyone has driven the Polestar 2 with a regular suspension. I'd love to hear from you. I'd love to hear how that drives. For me, though, this is the suspension to go with, and I would sacrifice a little bit of ride quality for that excellent handling dynamic package of this Polestar 2, that's for sure. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2021 Polestar 2 BEV. Hope you liked this piece. And if you did, you're not new to YouTube, but you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring. We only have one ask on this channel, and that's to share this on Reddit, especially to people who need to see reviews from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below, and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. And if you really want to support the channel, hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, or driving enthusiasts you may know, in case you need any gift ideas. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, and that includes electrics.